So I put these slides on the web. I don't know if you can see this, but in this, I mean, you can easily find it. And first, let me start with two things I forgot to say earlier. So here is a theorem which says that every uncountable chromatic graph contains all sufficiently large circuits. So this is a circuit, the C5, and similarly we define longer all the circuits, and any uncountable chromatic graph contains all long circuits. Circuits obviously have chromatic number 3. So we have the following corollary that if the chromatic number of two graphs, X and Y, are both uncountable, then there is a common three-chromatic subgraph. Any two uncountable chromatic graphs contain the same, there is a three-chromatic subgraph appearing in both, namely any sufficiently long odd circuit. And then Erdős asked, what about this? Is it true that any two uncountably chromatic graphs have a common finite four-chromatic subgraph? And this is not known. And I just want to show this because it's visible how trickily Erdős asked in some cases his questions. The point is that there is no, three chromatic graphs can easily be described. These are exactly those graphs which contain an odd circuit. Three chromatic if and only if there is an odd circuit. So this is the full characterization of three chromatic graphs, at least three chromatic graphs. There's no such characterization for four chromatic. So finite four chromatic graphs are extremely complicated, and there is no theory for that. So we cannot just say that these are exactly this, this, and this, and we try to find them. And so this is, as much as I know, nobody tried this conjecture, at least nobody succeeded in solving it. It's open. Absolutely open. And the second remark is that I had the Taylor conjecture. The Taylor conjecture said that if we have a graph with uncountable chromatic number, then for an arbitrary large cardinal lambda, there is a graph whose chromatic number is greater than lambda, and which contains the same finite subgraphs. And then I sketched two theorems. One is that this is false. And however, it is true, it is consistent that it is true if we replace Aleph 1 by Aleph 2. And these two, so it is consistent, then it is at most Aleph 2, this half number or whatever jumping number, And it is consistent that it is at least on F2. So together this suggests that the Taylor conjecture is true in ZFC, only we have to replace LF1 by LF2. Again, as you may remember, these proofs very heavily used the fact that we are forcing. So I don't see any argument or any idea that this could be this generalization or variant could be proved in ZFC. Okay. Okay. So here is Galvin's question. Is it true that the chromatic number has the so-called Darboux property? Namely, if we have a graph whose chromatic number is exactly lambda and kappa is any cardinal less than lambda, and there is a subgraph of X whose chromatic number is exactly kappa. So first of all, this is obviously true if lambda is finite. I mean, if lambda is 28, then there is a 28 chromatic finite subgraphs, and then we can go one by one and get any smaller chromatic number. It is true if kappa is LF0, because if the chromatic number is greater than LF0, then it contains arbitrary large chromatic finite subgraphs by the Erdős-Döbrön, and their union has chromatic number exactly LF0. So the first cases of the parameters when this is not obvious, if lambda is LF2 and kappa is LF1. Is it true that every graph of chromatic number LF2 contains a subgraph whose chromatic number is LF1? Now, obviously, removing edges one by one leads nowhere. Cannot get anything. There is a chance. So, for example, if we have a graph of size and chromatic number LF2. So here is a graph of size and chromatic number LF2. And if the Forman Leiber theorem holds that every such graph contains a subgraph of size and chromatic number LF1, then we have the statement. But this is a very special case, and also is just consistency. But the other thing is that we have an induced subgraph. So, okay, a subgraph generally means that a subset of the edge sets. We remove edges. We consider some of the edges. Induced subgraph is that we just take a subset of the underlying set and all the edges inside. So we remove vertices, or we consider some of the vertices. This is a stronger notion. By the way, the previous arguments for if the smaller cardinal is finite or LF0 give induced subgraphs. The other remark is that we obviously have this. I indicated, but it didn't show that this property holds if we replace the chromatic number by the coloring number, because we fully know the coloring number. The coloring number is lambda if and only if some type of subgraph appears. And we just remove enough edges, and then we get a certain subgraph which has coloring number at least kappa, but not greater than kappa. So for coloring number, this easily holds. And as it happened, this is Galvin found one case where this fails, namely if this cardinal arithmetic condition holds, and then there is a graph whose chromatic number is greater than LF1, but it has no induced subgraph whose chromatic number is exactly LF1. So the the chromatic number of the subgraphs may miss an element in the interval of the chromatic number of the full graph and zero. And the and the example is easy. This is just a shift graph on 2 to the LF2, because then we simply know, not only for induced subgraph, we know for all the induced subgraphs are certain types of shift graphs, and then we just know exactly the chromatic number of that. And however, this is weak in several points, because firstly, one has to assume this, and second, this only works for induced, so there are no induced subgraph. So, sorry? Yeah.
So the when you talk about the pairs, it's the it's called shift graph one. I'm just to
yeah.
About the meaning of the.
The underlying set are pairs. The underlying set is pairs. The vertices of the graph are all the pairs of this of the set of this cardinality. Two are joined. No, you join two pairs if they are consecutive.
Yeah, you take the counter example to the Weber Schreiber example. Oh, 2 out of 2, okay, sorry.
Yeah. Okay.
I read it to that. Okay.
Yeah. By the way, Ödös was very hurt that somebody could invent such a nice problem and not him. And in a very characteristic way, he started mentioning in his problem papers, well, Galvin asked this and this and this, and I'm very hurt that it was his question and not mine. Okay. It is consistent that there is a counterexample. So there is a graph with size and chromatic number LF2, so that there is no subgraph whose chromatic number is exactly LF1. And the proof is very simple. It's a finite support iteration of length omega 3. First, I add a graph on omega 2 with finite conditions. So there are finite conditions, and you just draw the graph on a finite set. And in an iteration of length omega 3, I consider all subgraphs whose chromatic number is LF1 at the moment we consider it. And then we color it. We force a good coloring of that graph with omega. So we force the most natural way all such LF1 chromatic subgraphs to have a good coloring with countermanic colors, and that works. This will be CCC. That's easy, and the hard part is to show that the chromatic number of X remains LF2. So that's a technical argument. Any questions or remarks? Okay. And I can generalize this. So if X is a graph, I can consider first the chromatic number of all induced subgraphs. All the chromatic number of all induced subgraphs of it. And I remove the finite numbers and LF0 because they are uninteresting at this moment. We know that they appear, so we don't care. And so what do we know about this set of cardinals? This is closed. It contains all its limit points. And if lambda is in it and is singular, then it is a limit point of it. There are two easy properties which immediately follow from the definition. And the same argument as we had before, for every non-empty set of uncountable cardinals, and there is here I forgot to write the essential things, which have these two properties. It's a set of cardinals which is closed, and every singular element of it is a limit point for that. So for example, it contains its supremum. There is a largest element because of it is closed. And there is a cardinal cofinality preserving forcing, which adds a graph so that this set is exactly A. Which basically means that you can apply the previous argument not only to kill Aleph 1 chromatic subgraphs, but to Aleph 1, Aleph 2, whatever is needed, so that all the unwanted cardinals for which I do not want to kill those chromatic subgraphs will survive. And of course, we can consider not only induced subgraphs. So in this definition, we consider the chromatic number of induced subgraphs. And we can do the same thing for all subgraphs. Let Sx be the chromatic number of all subgraphs of the set of chromatic numbers of all subgraphs of X. We remove the finite numbers and the Aleph not because they are not of interest in this case. Then again, we have that if lambda is singular, then it is a limit, as in the previous case. And also, if lambda is a limit point of this set of cardinals, then it is in. So for singular elements are limits, and the limit singular cardinals which are limits are in. But this set is not necessarily closed at regular cardinals. It is consistent from a measurable cardinal that Sx is not closed at a regular cardinal. The same technique, actually. So we add a large graph with finite conditions, and then we kill whatever subgraphs we want. Oh, here. So earlier I stole from Magidor, now I steal from Renaud. This is this topic of the chromatic number of graph products. So I have two graphs. X and Y on the two sets V and W, and we consider the Cartesian product of the sets, and we join two points in the product if and only if both its projectile are in the appropriate graphs. And Heiner raised the question if it is true that the chromatic number of two graphs X and Y is always the minimum of the chromatic number of X and the chromatic number of Y. We have seen that in this case there is a coloring, so we can project to either graph. And therefore, a coloring of this graph, a good coloring of this graph, gives a good coloring of the whole product. and the same for the other. So the chromatic number of the product is less than or equal to the minimum of the two chromatic numbers. The question is if we have equality here. And I know, but the reason why this was raised is that for finite chromatic number, if everything is finite, both the graphs and the chromatic numbers, there's a famous problem in combinatorics that if you have two n chromatic graphs, both finite, and we take the product of them, then the chromatic number of the product is exactly n. This is the so-called Hedet-Niemi conjecture. It's very old and it's absolutely unsolved. Maybe it is proved for n equals 4, at most 4. And there's a huge literature on this on the finite version of this. So Heiner asked, do we know anything in the infinite case? And firstly, he proved with the use of ultrafilters that the statement is true if the two chromatic numbers, one of the two chromatic numbers is finite, the other is infinite. So this is a finite chromatic graph, and this is an infinite chromatic graph. Then the chromatic number of the product is this finite number. So assume that the chromatic number of X is K plus 1. And so assume that the chromatic number of the product is at most K. Now, we consider an ultrafilter on the other set, on W, Y is an infinitely chromatic graph. So if we consider those subsets whose complement are finite chromatic, then this is a filter. Because the union of any two finite chromatic subsets is not the whole set. So we let U be an ultrafilter extending all co-finite chromatic sets. Then assume that the chromatic number of this graph is less than or equal to K. So there are K independent sets which cover the product. Now consider the rows. In every row, again, the rows are also decomposed into at most K sets. So exactly one of them is in U. So in every row, here are the rows. In each row, there is a large subset, a subset which is in the ultrafilter, so that all the elements in Thanks. Yeah, absolutely right. Yeah. So one is finite, k plus one, the other is infinite. By the way, we already used up that the chromatic number is infinite by the definition of U. So it's a good sign if you use the conditions of the theorem. Now, in each row, there is a large set so that all the points in that set get the same color. And this, so if X is this vertex, then all points in this large set get the same color, which depends on X, so it's IX. By the indirect hypothesis, we have only K. So this is a coloring of the vertices here with K elements. So as we assume that the chromatic number of the first graph is K plus 1, there are two points which get the same color. So the color of the elements in the large set in these rows is the same. And then we are done because it's a large set, so it contains an edge in Y. So the intersection of them is still large. There is an edge in it because it's not finite chromatic. So here we get build up an edge in the product. We can lift this edge to an edge in the product, and we are done. Now, next, Hoynal proved that if the chromatic number of X and Y is bigger than kappa, and the chromatic number of X times Y is less than kappa, then for any of the two cardinals, any of the two graphs, for example, for X, it is true if we take a sub graph of coordinate kappa, then it is of coordinate less than kappa. Which basically means that if we want to produce graphs whose whose product has chromatic number smaller than the two components, then we have to define graphs whose chromatic number jumps. So it's large the chromatic number, but all smaller subgraphs have a small chromatic number. So one has to use techniques techniques were used in the construction of graphs like that. First of all, Hoynal proved that there are two graphs whose chromatic number is kappa plus, but the chromatic number of the product is kappa. So the chromatic number of the product can be smaller than each of the components, factors. And actually there are many such examples. And for this, he used a construction of a large chromatic graph, which goes back to, I think, Galvin. So we build up the following tree of size, of height, kappa plus, so that T alpha contains all the functions from alpha into kappa, which is in injection. And F is made less than G. G is in T beta, F is in T alpha, then F is less than G if and only if G simply extends F. So we have all injections from alpha into kappa at level alpha, all injections from beta into kappa at level beta, and the ordering is exactly extension, this function extension. So the graph is the comparison graph of this tree. We have a tree, and we connect we join two points exactly if one extends the other. There's one statement which is obvious, that there is no kappa plus branch in this tree. So no kappa plus branch in T. Why? Because a branch would give a branch would give an injection of kappa plus an injection of copper plus into copper, which is impossible. So this is sort of a very fat tree, which obviously doesn't have a cofinal branch. And next, we prove that the chromatic number of this is copper plus. So assume that there is some good coloring f of this with copper many colors. What am I doing here? So we have to show that it is not special. So it cannot be covered by copper many anti-chains. And the simple argument is that we define by recursion on alpha less than copper plus elements so that each element is F alpha is on the alpha level. So F0 is the empty function. It limit steps we take unions. And if F alpha is given, then we extend it to the function which at the last point takes the color of F alpha, F of F alpha. Now, with induction, we can prove that this is a branch. Okay, so obviously F alpha plus 1 extends F alpha, and then by induction we get that any of the smaller index is extended to the larger index. So this is T beta, this is T alpha, and this is then a branch, but that's impossible because there is no cofinal branch. Okay, so basically here we start. Let me just reformulate the argument. Here we start with a one unique root, and then we go in that direction which causes the color of the root. And then again, this is the second point. And again, the way in which direction we go will be determined by the color assigned, this alleged color assigned to this. And these are injections because whenever we get 2 points, then their color, so F beta is less than F alpha, F alpha extends F beta, so the color assigned to F alpha is different from the color assigned to F beta. So when we collect all the colors, all the colorings up to the alpha level, these are different. So these are injections, and it gives a contradiction. So the chromatic number of the whole thing is copper plus. Now, we define delta as the set of all pairs which have the same which are in the same level. So we put this, and then I say that the product of this graph with itself is copper chromatic. Okay, this is not true. I mean, the product of this graph with itself is not obviously not copper chromatic because X cross X contains X. This is the diagonal. So I remove the diagonal. This is delta. But not the diagonal in the usual sense, P comma P, so every element is equal to itself, but the diagonal in the sense that elements in the same level. So now the product contains pairs F comma G, so that the domain of F is less than the domain of G. And here we have F comma G, so that the domain of G is less than the domain of F. And we prove that, that this part is Kappa chromatic, and obviously the same argument gives that this part is also Kappa chromatic. So assume that, here is the proof. So assume that, what does it mean that we have two elements here which are joined. This means that this is F G, this is F prime G prime, and F prime are joined, and G prime are joined. So what I do is that I associate the following color, capital F F G, is G at the domain of F. I evaluate the largest of the two at the domain of the smallest. And this is a good coloring. So here is F G and F prime G prime. The domain of F is alpha, the domain of G is beta, the domain of F prime is alpha prime, the domain of G prime is beta prime, and the color of, well, they're not indices, sorry, alpha, beta, alpha prime, beta prime, and I assume that the colors they get are the same, so G alpha is equal to G prime alpha prime. Now, G and G prime are connected, so they are comparable. Either G extends G prime or the other way around. But that's impossible. Yeah, alpha must be equal to alpha prime because the larger otherwise would get the same value at two points. So necessarily, this is only possible if alpha is equal to alpha prime. And now I'm stuck. But
like F tag is the restriction of F to the same order.
Yeah, thanks. Fortunately, we have the person who knows everything on the topic. And then the argument simply was that that we have to take two disjoint sets of levels. So if A is a set of ordinals below Kappa plus, then V is really T. We restrict the tree to levels in A, and if we take two disjoint sets A and B here, then we can multiply them, and the product will be Kappa chromatic. The point is that we have to show that there are two disjoint sets, so that both are Kappa plus chromatic. Okay, so here is the graph, the full graph, which we know that it is Kappa chromatic, and we take two disjoint sets of levels, and we only consider those graphs whose levels are in the respective sets. Okay, so this will be one graph, and this will be the other graph. And obviously, the product of the two graphs doesn't contain any element in the diagonal, because they do not have a common level, a common T alpha. So the only thing we have to prove that there are two sets which are disjoint, but the restriction of two of this graph to those levels which are in one or the other set, both have chromatic number kappa plus. And this is very easy because if we consider those sets, so that the restriction of those sets of the graph has chromatic number at most kappa, then this is a kappa plus complete, actually normal ideal on kappa plus, and there cannot be a prime ideal like that because that would make kappa plus a measurable cardinal. So the Ulam matrix, for example, gives that there are kappa plus disjoint sets like this, and then we are done. Okay, and then came the question. So this is a jump of one. So here the chromatic number of the factors is kappa plus, but the chromatic number of the product is kappa. So it goes down by one step. Can we go down by two or three or anything? And that this was a very hard, this became a very hard problem. Sokup actually did the consistency that there are two graphs of size and chromatic number are F2, so that the product of them is countably chromatic, but that argument didn't extend. I mean, there's no way that it extended. And then this guy sitting here could produce actually a large number of graphs with chromatic size and chromatic number lambda plus, so that the product has chromatic number countable for any two. So first of all, this is where you said that this is superfluous. So this is a very strong extension of both the diamond and the box principles. So and the point is that when you build, what is the essential point in the proof?
The point is that you have two graphs where there is some forcing extension where one graph is of high chromatic number and the other one becomes countably chromatic, and there is another universe where the other one has maximal chromatic number and the first one is small chromatic number.
Yeah.
So you can keep chromatic number of one without killing the other one and vice versa.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so it's a very, very complicated and nice argument. Okay. Okay. Now the least chromatic number. Oops. The least chromatic number is a generalization of the chromatic number. It's the least cardinal mu, so that I repeat the definition of the chromatic number, we can give a good coloring where all the colors are elements of mu. Rather than that, this is the least cardinal, so that whenever any set of size mu is associated with all the vertices, then we can pick an element from each, so that gives a good coloring. So the picture is something like this. Here is the graph. Now, in the case of chromatic number, we give the same set to all vertices as the set of possible colors. And here, in the case of the least chromatic number, we give totally different sets. And the mu is the smallest cardinal for which it is true that given an arbitrary series of sets of size mu, there is always a good coloring. We can always pick elements, each vertex gets one of the elements of the associate set, so that this is a good coloring. So Erdős used to say the enemy gives sets and we have to choose the good coloring. By the way, this was introduced by Erdős, this list. I was sure that this is something that comes from applications, but it appeared in a paper, first appeared in a paper of Erdős. Now, the problem for us is that the least chromatic number is in between the coloring number and the chromatic number. Okay, so let's prove this. But this is easy because the chromatic number is a special case of the least chromatic number. If it is true that we can color with all the elements of omega, this is a special case when we associate the same set for all of them, and possibly in the special case we can do it with less colors. Now let's see this. The least chromatic number is less than or equal to the coloring number. This is X. And each vertex is joined into less than mu many smaller vertices. So just this is the definition of the coloring number. And then various sets of possible colors are associated with all the vertices. And I claim that we can simply choose a good coloring from the associated sets via a transfinite recursion going on this well-ordered set. Why? Because when we arrive here, we have a set of coordinator mu of choosable colors. Some less than mu of them are discarded because they're already colors of the other endpoints of edges. So what? We remove those less than mu elements, something remains, so this is mu. So this is a very, very natural way of coloring it. The proof that the chromatic number is less than or equal to the coloring number actually gives that the least chromatic number is less than or equal to the coloring number. Now, it's interesting that somehow the least chromatic number has some identity crisis in the sense that it can be equal to the chromatic number and it can be equal to the coloring number. Not in the same time, obviously. So if, for example, if we assume the Martin axiom and we stick to graphs of size Aleph 1, then the least chromatic number is Aleph 1 if and only if the chromatic number is Aleph 1. So in this very special case, the least chromatic number is equal to the chromatic number. On the other hand, in a different model, the least chromatic number can be equal to the coloring number. Actually, it is consistent that for every size, so previous theorem applies only to Aleph 1 sized graph, but it is consistent then that the GCH holds and the least chromatic number is always equal to the coloring number. Less than?
In the same model.
Yes. The chromatic number and coloring number are different because bipartite graphs can have a large coloring number. I have to be careful what word to use. But it is consistent that this chromatic number and the coloring number are equal, assuming that this is infinite. Obviously, for finite Now, I want to mention this. This very nice result of Kochner, where is he? Vanished. They can be different, but not arbitrarily far. It never occurred to me that something like this can hold, but he, with sharp eyes, observed that there is a connection like that. And as this is, for this he uses this revised GCH theorem of Schellard. And recently Schellard pointed out that actually there is a more, there is a closer connection between these inequalities of this type and PCF theory. So if a certain hypothesis on PCF holds, then the Korning number can be as large as the nth iterated exponentiation of the least chromatic number, and vice versa. If there is such a thing, then at least in the first model, some PCF hypothesis holds. I mean, we immediately see so that. Yes. No, I mean that there is hope that there is a much stricter bond, but this depends on some unsolved PCF state. So it is hard. I mean, if he couldn't do that. Okay. And there's just one word. Oops. Okay. I just want to mention that even if, first of all, I consider the conjecture or the quest for a small, strongly compact cardinal for the chromatic numbers as perhaps the most important problem in infinite graph theory. But even if we could do that, there is the question of the chromatic number of systems of finite sets. So far, we consider graphs, which are systems of pairs, two element sets. It's a huge collection. Each set has two element sets. And what about if we consider triples? I have a hypergraph so that the edges are now three element subsets. A good coloring is again the same. It's a coloring of all the vertices with some number of colors so that no triple gets monocolored. The chromatic number is the least number of colors so that there is a good coloring with this number. So there's the setup, and this was already raised by Ördös and Hajnal in the 60s, but not much happened. For example, there's not even a conjecture what the obligatory substructures would be. So in the case of graphs, each finite bipartite graph must occur, and each graph, finite graph, which is not a finite, which is not a bipartite graph, can be eliminated. So that fully describes the obligatory subgraphs, obligatory in the sense of large chromatic number. What are the obligatory graphs in the case of triples? Nobody knows. And of course, the whole theory can be copied for that, but this seems to be infinitely harder. Thank you. I think that's it.
So what is the square diagonal?
It's a it's a principle which contains both square and diamonds, but it's not just the union of them. There are some, so they are interconnected. It's, do you remember it offhand?
Sure, yeah.
He does.
So square the diamond lambda, you have 50 contest x alpha alpha less than lambda plus, c alpha alpha less than lambda plus, and c alpha is just a square sequence. But, and the x alpha is like a diamond sequence, but you require this alpha bar in accumulation for the c alpha, that not only the c alpha bar is then extended by c alpha, but also x alpha bar is then extended by x alpha. So there is coherence not only on the cloud, but also on the guessing. Write it down, but I don't know.
That's just the Ramsey theory, which is again a very rich theory. So it is like the ordinary Ramsey theorem. Only we want monocolored copies of certain graphs. So rather than monocolored copy of a complete graph, we have some predictions. And this is, in a certain sense, is a generalization of the chromatic number, because the chromatic number is large means that no way how we color the vertices with countably many colors, there is a monocolored edge. And what if we want certain configurations in that? That's a rich theory. That's a different definition, yes.
It makes sense, and there are questions there.
Yeah, but it's no, it's less researched, but that's a different number. Thank you.